بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. I'll speak about management of infected total hip replacement. Post-operative infection is a very difficult complication. It's painful, disabling, costly, and often requiring removal of both components of the hip prosthesis, and is associated with the reported mortality rate of 2.5%. In modern days, the advances in understanding of the patient condition and the operating room environment, the surgical technique, and the use of prophylactic antibiotics have dramatically reduced the risk. We have a higher incidence, as Professor Kelly said, in diabetics, in rheumatological diseases, in obese patients, in coagulopathy, and in corticosteroid administration, preoperative anemia and sickle cell disease, and prolonged operative time and previous history of surgery. The causative organism is mainly Staph aureus, coagulase negative Staph, streptococci, enterococci, and gram-negative organisms. The mechanism involved in infection: direct contamination of the wound at the time of surgery, local spread of superficial wound infection, hematogenous spread of distant bacterial colonization and infection from a separate site, and reactivation of a latent hip infection in previously septic hip joint. Antibiotic prophylaxis: infections are caused by gram-positive organisms, particularly coagulase negative staphylococci and staphylococcus aureus. MRSA and Pseudomonas is mainly because of the presence of glycocalyx extension in the cell wall. The guidelines: intraoperative antibiotic administration guidelines. I have to choose the antimicrobial agent. I have to have to use the cephalosporins, cefazolin and sulfuramine. If beta-lactamase allergy, I have to use clindamycin or vancomycin. Consider preoperative screening for MRSA colonization. If infected or colonized with MRSA, I have to use vancomycin. The timing of administration, I have to start 60 minutes before incision in case of cephalosporins and clindamycin, and start up to 120 minutes, 2 hours before incision in case of vancomycin. The dosage in cefazolin, 1 to 2 grams, in cefuroxime, 1.5 gram, and in vancomycin and clindamycin, the dose is according to the patient mass. The duration of antimicrobial use: this is the recommended. We usually do not respect this in our work in suspected cases, but this is the guidelines for recommended cases. I have to administer single preoperative dose and redose antimicrobial antimicrobial agent intraoperatively for prolonged procedures or significant blood loss. When using postoperative doses, I have to discontinue within 24 hours after wound closure. The classification of infection postoperatively: in Sukoyama classification, I have number one, early postoperative infection, onset within 1 month; late chronic infections, onset more than 1 month and insidious onset; acute hematogenous infection, onset more than 1 month after surgery, and acute onset of symptoms, usually from a distant source or distant focus of infection; and positive intraoperative cultures, positive cultures obtained at the time of revision for supposedly aseptic condition. The extended classification by Tambuz and Zemmerli: number one, early infection, up to 3 months postoperative; delayed infection, 3 months up to 24 months; late infection, more than 24 months. And in another classification, acute less than 1 month and late more than 1 month. Diagnosis: diagnosis of early postoperative infection in acute hematogenous infection is often not so difficult. Late chronic infection is difficult for diagnosis. The clue for understanding or for suspicion is a well-functioning arthroplasty with pain that's not subsiding with analgesics. History of excessive wound drainage after the initial arthroplasty is a clue for the presence of infection. multiple episodes of wound erythema. Prolonged antibiotic treatment by the operating surgeon also are worrisome. Lab reports, ESR more than 30 millimeter per hour, C-reactive protein more than 10 milligram are sensitive and specific. Normal patient ESR may take up to 1 year for normalization, but the C-reactive protein should normalize within 3 weeks after replacement. Aspiration not undertaken until after 3 weeks of stopping antibiotics. The arthrogram. The arthrogram is very important, which showed the pseudopercal periosteal ossification sinus tracts. And this is an example of the arthrogram. This is done in cases with a sinus. Of course, Dr. Kelly speaks about the biofilm that's present in infected cases. The ideal scenario for diagnosis, when abnormal ESR and C-reactive protein are found in combination with an aspirate white blood cell count greater than 3,000 leukocytes per milliliter, is highly suspicious for infection. Radionucleotide study for infected total HEP. Nuclear medicine studies may be obtained if the diagnosis is not confirmed by HEP aspiration, but still there is a higher instance of suspicion remains. The combination of indium-labeled leukocyte and technetium sulfur colloid-labeled marrow imaging seems to be more reliable. The International Consensus on Periprosthetic Infection Guidelines. Two positive periprosthetic cultures with phenotypically identical organism, or sinus tract communicating with the joint, or having three of the following minor criteria: elevated C-reactive protein and ESR, elevated synovial fluid white blood cell count, or change on leukocyte stress test strip, and elevated synovial fluid polymorph nuclear leukocytes, neutrophils. Positive histological analysis of periprosthetic tissue and a single positive culture. The main problem with infection is loosening of the implants, the septic loosening of implants. And this is the main reason for revision of the HEP. Femoral and acetabular loosening, either septic or aseptic, are some of the most serious long-term complications of total HEP arthroplasty, and these commonly lead to revision. Some studies define failure of radiographic evidence of loosening despite continued satisfactory clinical performance. When I speak about loosening, عشان أسهل الأمور and to be more easily, instead of saying that the loosening is in the around the greater trochanter or around the lesser trochanter or the between the lesser trochanter and the subtrochanteric area, I have the zones of femoral and acetabular zones. The zones around the cement in the cement mass in the femur, described by Groman and as described by Dilley and Charlie in the acetabulum. In the femur, we have seven zones, zone 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's in both AP and lateral. And Dilley and Charlie, we have three zones. This is for simplification. This is an ideal way for discussing the areas of loosening with other colleagues. He will understand that I have a loosening in zone 6 or in zone 4 or in zone 7. He will automatically understand where is the location of the loosening. The femoral loosening, cemented femoral component loosening, radiolucency below between groin zone 1 equals debonding of stem from the cement and early stem deformation. Radiolucency between the cement mantle and the surrounding bone, these are the signs, sure signs of loosening. The substance of the stem or with cement mantle. لو أنا لقيت عندي السيمنت والستم كان في ليفل معين وبعدين بدأ ينزل يبقى حصل substance هو ومع السيمنت. This is a sure sign of loosening, of course. Femoral stem becoming in a varus position. I did the total hip replacement. The stem was in a valgus or neutral position. And after some time on serial follow-up x-rays, I found it changed in the position and become in a varus position. This is a sure sign of loosening. Fragmentation in growing zone 7. وده قلنا فايدة الزونز أعرف فين بالضبط الموجود loosening. Fragmentation of the cement in growing zone 7 is a sure sign of loosening. Fragmentation of cement in growing 4 zone. Deformation of the stem or fracture of the stem. لو أنا لقيت عندي في deformation of the stem بدأ الستم يتعوج أو حصل له even fracture, this is a sure sign of loosening. Harrison McCarthy defined femoral component losing radiologically into a definite loosening when there is migration of the component or the cement, probable loosening when a complete radiolucency is noted around the cement mantle, and possible loosening when an incomplete radiolucency surrounding more than 50% of the cement. For the acetabular loosening, cemented acetabular components changes in the pelvis and the acetabular component. It's, number one, absorption of the bone from around part or all of the cement mantle. Number two, cephalic translation combined with sagittal plane rotation. I found the acetabulum, the inclination of the acetabulum has changed. It's a cephalic orientation. The antiversion is changed. Of course, this is a sure sign of loosening. Wear of the cup as indicated by a degrees. The wear is very important sign. Degrees in the distance between the surface of the head and the periphery of the cup. This indicates that there is wear of the polyethylene. Fracture of the cup and cement. Femoral loosening occurs at the stem-cement interface. This is a very important statement. The femoral loosening occurs at the stem-cement interface, but the acetabular loosening occurs at the cement-bone interface. Acetabular loosening starts at the periphery and progresses towards the dome. I have to look for the radiolucency and the horizontalization of the cup. For the cementless acetabular components, loosening of cementless porous coated acetabular component is an uncommon finding as compared with cemented acetabulum. And Graffin and Marx classified classification. They classified the cementless acetabular component into stable, probably unstable, and definitely unstable. The diagnosis, septic loosening produces pain on movement and pain at rest. For the acetabular component, there is a start-up pain, which is worse in the first few steps. Early post-operative pain suggests infection. Loosening diagnosis is done only on follow-up x-ray. I have to have serial follow-up x-rays, and this is the only diagnostic sign of loosening. I have to check for the loosening lines and loose zones in serial follow-up x-rays. Adjunctive investigations, arthrography and nuclear medicine studies, as we have mentioned. Arthrography shows layer around the acetabular cup, which shows loosening. The management principles. Number one, antibiotic prophylaxis and antibiotic therapy, debridement and irrigation of, the wound with component retention, debridement and irrigation of the HEP with component removal, one-stage or two-stage re-implantation of total hip arthroplasty, and the final decision is Girdlestone excisional arthroplasty. The management depends on, number one, the chronicity, the virulence of the organism, the status of the wound, and the surrounding soft tissues. Decision for component retention or removal. What's the main deciding factor for dealing with the prosthesis? If I have less than 2 weeks of presentation since the onset of symptoms, I can deal with the infection with debridement and irrigation. I can still leave the prosthesis. ولكن لو أنا عندي more than 2 weeks of presentation since the onset of symptoms, I have to debride. So if I have less than 2 weeks of presentation since onset of symptoms, I have to go with debridement and leaving the prosthesis, retention of the prosthesis. But if I have more than 2 weeks of presentation since onset of symptoms, I have to do debridement and component removal. Early post-operative infection. Early infections may range in severity from superficial cellulite, which is mainly dealt with antibiotics, to deep infection, which requires surgical management. Decision making for medical and surgical lines of treatment with extension depends on the extension of the infection, whether below or superficial to the deep fascia. Surgery required if wound dehiscence, skin necrosis, infected hematoma. If the joint is infected superficially, then the wound is to be opened in the operating theater. It's opened down to the deep fascia, and the structures are examined carefully to see whether the infection extends under it. If the infection is superficial, the wound is thoroughly irrigated with large quantities of physiological solutions containing antibiotics, and all necrotic subcutaneous tissues and skins are excised. If the infection extends to the hip joint, the wound debridement and irrigation with antibiotic solution, the hip must be dislocated to perform this procedure thoroughly. If modular components, and this is very important, in modular components, if modular components has been implanted, the liner, the femoral head has to be exchanged to limit the any instance of contamination from foreign bodies. And wounds are closed over drains. Cultures of joint fluid or other fluid collections encountered along with tissue cultures from the superficial and deep spaces and periprosthetic layers are sent for analysis. For the late chronic infection, surgical debridement and component removal are required if eradication of the infection is to be done. Sinus tracts are debrided. Non-absorbable sutures and trochanteric hardware all have to be removed. The hip is dislocated and all infected and necrotic material is excised. The femoral and acetabular components and any other foreign material, including cement, cement extractors, cables, or wires, all have to be removed and exchanged, of course. One recommendation is for non-removal and of, this is a very important topic. If I have a well-fixed femoral component and it can be removed, I can retain it, I can leave it. Because if I have to remove a well-fixed femoral or acetabular component in case of infection, this will lead to more bone loss and more destruction of bone. Cultural sensitivity of synovium and necrotic tissue is seen. If antibiotic containing beads or spacers have been placed, some authors have recommended that drains not to be used to maintain high concentrations of antibiotics. كنا بنحط على طول acceptable beads containing gentamicin and antibiotics. Acute hematogenous infection. The hip becomes acutely painful long after the index operation. The infection may have been caused by hematogenous spread from a remote site of infection or from transient bacteremia caused by an invasive procedure. The clinical picture, I have find that the patient's complaining of pain on weight bearing, on motion of the hip, and at rest is the chief symptom and sign of acute hematogenous infection. Lab investigations, ESR and C-reactive protein. Diagnosis is established by joint aspiration. Joint aspirated fluid shows raised white blood cell count, positive cultures, and relevant sensitivity. While reports on cultures are being done, broad spectrum antibiotics, I take the synovial fluid or the cultures from the tissue. I send it for culture sensitivity. I have to give, I don't wait for the culture results. I have to give a broad spectrum antibiotics against both gram positive and gram negative organisms till the culture results are obtained. More aggressive approach includes complete removal of components and immediate reimplantation. And we'll speak about it one stage or two stage with primary cementless components. Reconstruction after infection. Decision-making in reimplantation of new prosthesis, according to the functional impairment of the patient, the infecting organism, is it a low virulence or high virulent organism, the adequacy of debridement and control of local and distant infection. Reimplantation is done as Dr. Kelly said, one stage or direct exchange, two stage or delayed exchange. Delayed reimplantation, of course, is advantageous. There is very limited indications for the one-stage exchange because it carries a higher risk of reinfection. For the two-stage or delayed reimplantation, it's very advantageous because of the adequacy of debridement. Debridement is ensured because repeated debridement of soft tissue may be done. Infecting organisms are identified in the culture and treatment started. Any foci of local or distant infection can be identified and eliminated, and decision regarding resection arthroplasty can be done. One stage exchange is done. What's the indications of one stage? When effective antibiotics are available and systemic symptoms of sepsis are absent. The contraindications, of course, two main things. If I have a sinus tract, this is absolute contraindication for one stage exchange. And the skin condition, if I have soft tissue compromise, this is an absolute contraindication for one stage exchange. Two stage is indicated in septic patients, sinus tracts, unidentified organisms, soft tissue compromise. Reimplantation with cement or cemented or cementless is guided by available bone stock, physiological age, and expected longevity of the patient. The Duncan and Beauchamp two-stage technique. This technique is in which a prosthesis of antibiotic-loaded acrylic cement, Stalag, and a hot spacer, I remove the prosthesis, I put an antibiotic-loaded spacer, is implanted in the time of the initial debridement. The prosthesis is constructed intraoperatively by molding antibiotic-laden cement around the femoral component and an all polyethylene acetabular component. This is the spacer. Components are interference fed, simplifying while extraction. Current guidelines for reimplantation. Number one, at least 6 weeks of antibiotics. ESR and C-reactive protein should be negative. Repeated hip aspiration negative reports. Reconstruction done at 3 months interval. Restoration of limb length and full motion should not be expected. Of course, the results of revision are not satisfactory as in the primary hip replacement. If trochanteric osteotomy is done, the limb is lengthened and abductor weakness is present. I have to have some time to release the iliopsoas and the gluteus maximus tendon to have a proper hip reduction. If acetabular wall is thin, I have to be very careful because with oversized implants, I may have a fractured acetabulum. Femoral canal preparation, avoiding fractures. وكان في لما كنا بنتكلم في الـ في الـ في الايفورت الايفورت سيشن اللي فات اللي هو كان في مؤتمر جمعيه جراحه العظام المصريه وكان في بروفيسور من هولندا اي ثينك من هولندا كان بيتكلم على البروفيلاكتيك سيركلاج وايرنج ديورينج فيمورال بريباريشن. This is a very important step for prevention of periprosthetic fractures. Frozen sections of tissues can be examined for residual inflammation. The last thing is the Girdlestone arthroplasty. Using standard approach, the head of the femur, the neck, the greater trochanter is exposed and removed. Here, head, neck, greater trochanter, and infected synovium all are removed through debridement then the skin is closed. Followingly, I have to put the patient on skeletal traction, 3 to 10 kilograms for 6 weeks. And of course, the girdle stone arthroplasty is done in patients unsuitable and unfit for re-implantation. I only في الحالات the patient not suitable for surgery. And this is after traction followed by mobilization. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Muhammad. شكرا يا باشا على المحاضرة الجميلة دي.
شكرا دكتور محمد. شكرا دكتور إبراهيم بي.
شكرا يا باشا. ميرسي جدا المحاضرة.
شكرا يا فندم.
واحنا الحقيقة يا باشا معانا كده يعني الدكتور عبد العال بيسأل كده على سكت
دكتور محمد الصوت بيقطع. أنا مش سامع.
طب واضح كده واضح كده دكتور محمد؟
كده واضح كده واضح حبيبي.
Question from Dr. Abdelal, case periprosthetic joint infection, discharging since 3 months. He decided to do the debridement, but he found the dressing embedded within the wound. He took it out and made the debridement and washed. He asked if this is sufficient or something else should be done.
No, after three months, I think this is not sufficient. 3 months of discharging wound, just debridement, this is not sufficient. احنا قلنا في التوك بتاعنا ان هو لو الديسشارج اقل من 2 weeks I may do debridement and thorough debridement cleaning of the deep below the tissues below the deep fascia. Sometimes I have to dislocate the hip to have cleaned all the tissues in the hip joint, but after 3 months of wound discharge, no, I have to remove the prosthesis.
Also, Dr. Abdelal بيسأل يا باشا يعني this periprosthetic joint infection, the guidelines deal with the conventional total hip, but the issue is somewhat different regarding surface replacement arthroplasty. What do you think?
I think the guidelines of infection are the same for all prostheses. If you have infection, chronic infection, more than maybe 1 month, let's see, more than 1 month, not 2 weeks. More than 1 month, you have to consider removal of the prosthesis. Less than 1 month, or as guidelines said, 2 weeks, but ممكن in general نتكلم على 1 month. Less than 1 month, debridement may be efficient and prolonged use of antibiotics. لو أنا عندي prosthesis is stable, أنا فعلا لو أنا لقيته إن هو very stable, عشان اشيله واشيل السمنت بتاعه ده هيعمل لي فعلا more tissue destruction and more bone loss than to leave it.
تمام يعني نفس الجايدلاينز تقريبا. دكتور وائل ابو زيد بيسال يا باشا regarding the prophylactic circulage wiring during the femoral canal preparation. Many circulage wires should be used in which level?
على multiple levels. على كذا level. يعني بنبدأ من تحت الليزر تروكانتر وبعدين عند السب تروكانتريك اريا وتحتها هنقول باي 5 سنتيمتر. هو كان البروفيسور الهولندي بيتكلم at least 3 سيركلاج وايرز بروفيلاكتيك 3 سيركلاج وايرز at least may be used to overcome and prophylactically overcome the periprosthetic femoral fractures during revision.
تمام اعتقد يا باشا كده مفيش اسئله ثانيه.
I have a comment regarding
Dr. Brady, اتفضل يا فندم.
The prophylactic.
لا ده احنا عايزين نسمع حضرتك
دكتور Brady.
خبرة حضرتك عالية في الأرثروبلاستي ما شاء الله.
Regarding the prophylactic circulage wiring, you know, the it is also depending on the design of the stem.
Yes.
Like if I'm doing grasping for a long stem, the polar stem, for example, is a long stem.
Yeah.
If you're using like tri-lock, it is a short stem. So if you rasp with a small rasp, no need to put 3-4 wires, you know.
Yeah.
But if using long rasp or the brush is long, then you can use more wires.
Yes.
So it is depending on the design of the stem.
بس هو الريفيجن دكتور ابراهيم بيه حضرتك غالبا بيبقى بلونج ستيم ولا حضرتك ممكن
لا لا انا بتكلم البروفلاكتيك ان دي برايمري هيب
In the revision.
The revision usually, like, if you use modular stem, so you, usually if you do it, like, most of cases, we're using the modular stem. Conconical.
تمام. هو حضرتك احنا بنستعمل البروفيلاكتيك وايرنج في revision اكتر منه بكتير او في البرايمري. Rarely قوي ان احنا نعمل بروفيلاكتيك وايرنج في البرايمري فاند.
في البرايمري because like if you go for cementless,
yeah,
sometimes you we using it even in the cementless if you feel the anterior wall, especially the femoral anterior cortex,
yeah,
sometimes in the revision, as you mentioned, Mr. Professor Muhammad, at least three to cover the up to the isthmus, like up to the isthmus.
Yes, yes,
because this is the most stress portion of the femur.
Yes, yes, of course.
And also
absolutely right.
When you like, you know, the normal thing, normal instruction, like when you do the rasp or the hammering, you should wait 10 seconds between each hit to leave
for the plasticity of the femur.
Yeah, yeah, the hope stress is to release, yeah, and then you can go. This is the general rule for this.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you all for this night.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. احنا عايزين نسمع خبرة حضرتك يا دكتور إبراهيم بيه.
يا باشا انا غلبان.
لا العفو يا فندم, لا العفو ده احنا كلنا بنتعلم من بعض يا فندم. العفو
هو احنا we have a low threshold for revision and if you suspect infection we'll go, especially you know we have some special, as we mentioned, the patient related factors. Our patient is more old, like the aging, a lot of comorbidities, so if the patient became septic, he got sepsis, the mortality rate is so high, like you know this. So the we have low threshold in the revision, to do revision or to go for the infection to operate. And also I just to clarify something regarding the dire or the to leave the implant. Usually most of us changing the polyethylene liner.
Yeah,
like this is the easy thing to do, to make a thorough washout, and we change the liner as a routine, even if we're leaving the implant. I think you know.
But احنا عندنا حضرتك الانفكشن دكتور ابراهيم في مصر definitely بيختلف عن الانفكشن في ايرلند, في المانيا, في انجلترا, definitely يعني. احنا rarely ان احنا بنلجا للوان ستيج اكستشينج او الوان ستيج ريفيجن, ده very rarely. احنا دايما بندخل في التو ستيج. حضرتك ممكن بتعملوه عندكم في ايرلند الوان ستيج؟
في ناس بتعمل, بس يعني هو طبعا انا بقول يعني دايما اللي بيعمل وان ستيج, احنا حتى معانا كونسلتنت في اليونت بيعمله, بس هو انا بعتبره قرار في منتهى الشجاعه يعني.
طيب بتاخد حضرتك انترا اوبراتيف, ممكن تاخد انترا اوبراتيف كالتشرز وفروزن سيكشنز.
This is the only way because if you or some people do aspiration,
yes,
under image guidance before the surgery,
yes,
like I'm taking few samples to be sure that we have and we know the organism, and we discuss with the microbiology to see if this organism is not virulent organism.
Yeah.
We have some antibiotic to deal with this, then we can go for single stage. But to be honest, the results of single stage, like it is not.
Yeah. The regiment of post-operative antibiotic for Ireland, هل زي انجلترا وزي المانيا؟ يعني I think بالنسبة لنا هو ده not sufficient at all.
لا احنا
كنت لسه في ميتنج على البوست اوبراتيف انتي بايوتيك والبري اوبراتيف بروفيلاكسس. طبعا ده نوت سفيشنت اتول.
احنا عندنا يعني وي هاف ا جود سيرفيس سمثينج كولد اوبات. ذا اوبات از لايك اوت بيشنت انتيبيوتيك ثيرابي. ذا تيم ويل جو تو ذا بيشنت ات هوم اند جيف هيم ذا انتيبيوتيك فور 6 ويكس فور 8 ويكس اكوردنج تو ذا بلان. سو وي هاف اند ذس ويل بي تايمد, يعني العيان مش هيفوت جرعه ولا. The patient will take his antibiotic in the proper time, in the proper dose. This is the for the proper duration. So we have a good service for this. If the patient, you are afraid of the compliance or something, then you can keep the patient in the hospital. Also, we have something. We have the we called it step down, like the nursing home, some convalescent hospital for recovery. So we can go give the patient the antibiotic in these hospitals. To have like available beds in our hospital, and also the patient is still having the antibiotic in a good time and a good dose. And also we all the time discussing with the microbiology, because we have this facility, you know, we give us guidance. This is the problem. And also for the chronic infection, we have the chronic suppressive antibiotic for 18 months. We have this regime and we have people following up this and dealing with this. And also we have nurses, community nurse will see, will review the patient, the wound. If there is any problem, she will contact us and send the patient to us in the clinic to see what the update. So this is the point. The problem in Egypt, I know the service is not available, so you can lose the patient. vision can disappear for weeks and come back with.
لا طبعا هو البيشنت نفسهم مختلفين وعدد البيشنتس طبعا لا اكتر بكتير يعني.
طبعا انا عارف يا دكتور محمد الوضع طبعا اصعب مش سهل، غير برضو الكوست يعني الكوست بتاعت الانتبيوتيك.
بالظبط. احنا بنشكر حضرتك دكتور ابراهيم بيه على اليوم الجميل اللي قضيناه مع حضرتك ده. ثانك يو سو ماتش. يعني بصراحه احنا استفدنا من خبراتكم كتير يا فندم.
تحت امر حضرتك.
وسعاده لنا ان احنا نشوف حضرتك دايما دكتور ابراهيم معانا.
ده شرف لي والله دكتور محمد.
وطبعا ميني ثانكس تو بروفيسور جون كيلي فور جوينينج اس تونايت. دكتور محمد القاضي سعدنا بوجودك معانا حبيبي، انت موجود معانا على طول عموما يعني. وان شاء الله هنشوف حضراتكم باذن الله تعالى يوم الخميس الجاي.